let's have a talk on innovative marketing in the digital era with Seema Gupta, Associate Professor, Chair, PGP in Enterprise Management, IIM Bangalore. Please put your hands together for Seema Gupta.
Everyone, I'm happy to be here. We are living in wonderful times because I'm a digital marketer and I live, breathe and eat digital marketing. So I'm sure all of you would agree that this is one of the best times to be in as a digital marketer. There's so much action which is happening all around us that the scope for creativity is just unlimited. So what we will do in 20-25 minutes that I have here is I will try and showcase some of the interesting digital marketing campaigns which have happened, and many of these are award winning, and use these to arrive at some principles or help you take away few things at the end of the session. Simple thing which I firmly believe is number one thing in digital marketing, you cannot do all hygiene type of marketing. So when we say digital, you can either do hygiene marketing or you can do impact marketing. Not just digital, every marketer. So one question that you have to really ask yourself is, are you happy being just a hygiene marketeer? What does a hygiene marketeer do? A hygiene marketeer doesn't take risk. A hygiene marketeer plays a safe game. A hygiene marketeer runs some drab campaigns on Facebook or Twitter or does search engine marketing and tries to acquire customers. But is that enough? Certainly not. So why it's not enough? Because there's so much clutter everywhere. And that's not new to all of you. I'm sure all of us are facing the challenge that there is so much noise that we can't be heard. So the only way to be heard is by doing some innovation. And the only way to innovate is by taking some risk. So one simple mantra I would like to leave before we get into videos is simple rule of 70-20-10. So what does it mean? 70% of your marketing can be hygiene marketing. So you run, whether you are running ads on TV or print or you are running campaigns on digital, but it's all very routine stuff. You are acquiring customers, you are retaining customers, but there's no risk and there's no breaking the clutter. But every day you can't afford to take risk. So 70% of your marketing, let it be routine. But the remaining 30% of the marketing has to be innovative. And again, we can divide the remaining 30% into two buckets. So 20%, which is medium risk, and 10%, which is very high risk. Because in marketing, simple mantra is you take risk and you reap the rewards. Now, will it work always? Not necessarily. So do we have it in our DNA to take those risks and to take those leap of faiths? As a marketer, we have to question what is the DNA of our organization. So when you come up with a brilliant idea and an innovative campaign, do you get the backing of your CMO? Do you get the backing of your CXOs? If not, then can we create that culture in the organization so that there is some innovation which is happening? Oh my God. Why we are showing, I mean, such big. So, we can, 30% of the marketing budget should be for innovative marketing. And we can start with seeing some examples and then draw some more inferences from there.
Can you actually use social media to plug the gaps in the sales and distribution network in a huge country like India? Can social media get consumers to voluntarily work on the most technical aspects of a brand? Will brands be able to set up alternate sales and distribution networks using social media in the future? Hippo Baked Munchies may have found some first answers. Hippo Baked Munchies had a simple philosophy to help establish itself in the $1.5 billion Indian snack market. Exceeding expectations, the packs were flying off the shelves across 400,000 stores within hours. As 92% of the Indian market is still unorganized retail, unexpected sales overwhelmed Hippo's new but efficient sales and distribution network, and they found it challenging to keep track of the stock, identify empty stores in time, and restock to match the super demand for Hippo. How do you support an overwhelmed sales and distribution network and help them cope with the demand for Hippo by the hour and plug the supply gap? Hippo turned to social media to do something that it has never been expected to do before, to track stock and reinforce a sales and distribution network. Hippo asked his followers on Twitter to send him a tweet whenever they couldn't find Hippo in stores and promised to replenish stocks within hours. Soon, tweets were pouring in from over 45 cities. People were tweeting from hypermarkets, supermarkets, and their local grocery store. Hippo set up a call cell, which instantly passed the information that came in as tweets to the sales and distribution teams of the respective areas. This way, Hippo was able to identify empty racks faster and restock locations within hours. Hippo gave regular meticulous updates on stock replenishment to the people who tweeted in and informed Hippo about unavailability. At zero cost, the number of people tracking stocks across markets over Twitter were equivalent to 50% of its sales and distribution network itself. Hippo even sent out personalized anti-hunger hampers to the most active tweeters, complete with a handwritten note. And as people saw Hippo packs reappearing in stores on demand, Hippo's cult following on the internet began to grow. Blogs and articles began to pop up all over. Since demand was never a problem, by matching it with supply, Hippo managed to up its sales by 76% in its first few months of launch. The campaign even helped Hippo identify, gauge demand, and prioritize its high potential new markets. While this campaign blurred the line between direct marketing, social media, and promotional campaigns, Hippo also effectively used social media to do what no one had done before: reinforce and support its sales and distribution network. To sum it up, Hippo killed hunger and four birds with one stone. Actually, with one bird.
So very often, the moment we say digital marketing or Facebook or Twitter, many of the campaigns that we see around are quite frivolous. But here, what we saw was something which was actually contributing to the distribution of the product. So you are using digital marketing for strategic purposes. So here, the second principle that I would want to leave you with is, when you are thinking of digital marketing, look at whether it's strategic or is it tactical. You should always blend your tactical marketing with some strategic marketing. Digital is very powerful. It can contribute or complement your sales and distribution. It can help in arriving at consumer insights. And you can change the brand associations with the help of digital. So to give you an example, we all know Kisan, the ketchup brand. They undertook a social listening exercise. So when we say digital, there are so many tools which are available. There are so many metrics, right? So they deployed a social analytical or a listening tool, and they got interesting consumer insight. So what were people talking about Kisan? People were saying the ketchup is made of cheap ingredients, which is like pumpkin. They were not talking about tomatoes. They were talking about pumpkin. And they were associating the brand Kisan with pumpkin. Now, you are getting this insight from social listening. And that led to the birth of a campaign idea, which was Kisanpur. So the brand came up with the bottles which came along with the seeds of tomato plants. And they motivated users to plant the seed in their kitchen garden. So tomato is like a necessary ingredient in everybody's kitchen, and it's a good kitchen garden item. So the company motivated users to involve the children and experience the whole thing of putting the seeds and seeing the sapling grow. And then they set up a Facebook page. So users were motivated to click the snaps and share their experience and how the sapling is growing on the company's or the brand's Facebook page. And then the company organized an offline event. In the event, people were asked to bring their tomatoes and the plant. And then a customized recipe was undertaken. So every household told whether they wanted ketchup with onion or garlic or spicy or chili garlic or whatever. And then customized ketchup was made and the name of the person put on the bottle and it was gifted back. So what is the brand trying to say here? Brand is saying that this ketchup is made from the tomatoes you grew. It's not made from pumpkin. And this communication was done with the help of campaign. And the idea for the campaign came from social media. So social media has to be used in strategic way as well. It should not just end into some frivolous things. Another interesting campaign that I am reminded of in the same context, using digital for strategic and not just tactical purposes, is one which won the Cannes Award for Nivea. Now, Nivea is a very popular brand. So it stands for skin protection and sunscreen protection and so on. They came up with a sort of band which could be attached on the wrist of the child. And people had to download an app from Play Store. And from this app, they could set the distance where the children can go, how far the children can go on a beach. So what is Nivea trying to do? It's trying to protect your children from drowning on the beach. So it's not the same as protection against sun, but it is extending the idea of protection, and the brand is trying to occupy a larger territory. And it is fostering a much bigger emotional connect because your kid is involved. And the target audience here, the beauty is, it's very sharply focused. So who was the target audience? Target audience were young mothers who were living near Rio de Janeiro beaches. And they had iPhone, so they could download the app. And they were subscribers of a magazine which had that humid resistant paper which they had to tear from the magazine. So they basically, it was a convergence of media. The target audience was very sharp, young mothers living near Rio de Janeiro beaches, and the idea is protection, and the brand is protecting the child so that parents can have their own fun on the beach. So the point I want to leave here is, any marketing which is not gimmicky is going to last much longer. Digital marketing, when it is used for a mere gimmick, will give you the eyeballs, will break the clutter, but will not have that emotional connect or will not solve a consumer problem. So with digital, if you can solve a real consumer pain point, then that marketing will have a more lasting impact. Okay, we can look at some other campaigns and then take this discussion forward.
Lacta is the leading milk chocolate brand in Greece. Its advertising has always been about people in love, comparing the feeling to Lacta's sweet taste. Translates to Lacta, the sweetest part of your life.
While building the Facebook strategy for Lacta, we came upon a unique insight. People were comparing their loved ones to Lacta chocolate, writing, "You might not be Lacta, but you're the sweetest part of my life." So we made an application that did exactly that. It allowed people to send virtual Lacta chocolates to their loved ones on Facebook, comparing them to Lacta's sweet taste. Users could choose among the four different Lacta flavors and write their lover's name on the chocolate wrapper in place of the actual Lacta brand. As a result, the sender appeared to post a message on the Facebook wall of the recipient, visible to all their friends, saying, "You might not be Lacta, but you are the sweetest part of my life." Additionally, the image of the custom Lacta was posted on the sender's photo gallery, tagged with their lover's name, permanently available for everyone to see. The application quickly became a viral hit among young people in Greece. In the first weeks, more than 135,000 users sent out some 300,000 virtual Lacta chocolates. As a result, our Facebook page quickly gained a big audience, and from 87,000 users, it exploded to 250,000 fans in 2 months, making it the most popular Facebook page for any brand in Greece. But most of all, the application had a positive side effect we could have never anticipated. Hundreds of users set their customized Lacta as their profile photo on Facebook, resulting into an online trend that overtook Greek Facebook by surprise. It's difficult to estimate the media value of all this voluntary exposure. What's certain is that users valued our application more than we could ever imagine, because it enabled them to express and share their love. And that's very sweet.
So Lacta is it's a market leader in Greece in the chocolate category. And what a wonderful insight. The idea for this campaign is rooted in consumer insight. And the insight was that people were comparing their loved ones with Lacta. And the whole campaign is based on that idea. So again, if you deploy analytics and if you listen to the voice of the customer, which social media is very amenable to, then you can get wonderful insights, and the campaigns which are based on those insights are likely to create waves. So here, one point which we can take away is that we have to look at strengths of each platform or each medium. Now, digital is such a big landscape. So you have search engine marketing, which is your Google or Yahoo or Bing on one side. And then you have social media, which includes your LinkedIn or Twitter or Facebook and so on, and YouTube. And then you have the entire web analytics piece or online PR and online reputation management and so on. So there are plethora of channels and mediums on digital. We have to understand the pros and cons of each platform and utilize the strengths of the platform to attain our objectives. Now here, they have utilized the strength of Facebook. What is the strength of Facebook? So anybody from audience, what do you think is the strength of Facebook?
Audience.
So audience, huge. I mean, is it about reach? What else?
Data.
So there's a lot of data. Facebook knows more about us than any other platform, because as Professor Jose was saying, 2.1 billion people are on Facebook and the world's population is 7 billion. So just almost everybody is on Facebook. Okay, what else? Sorry?
Reach.
Absolutely. Another strength of Facebook is that it has very good APIs. So Facebook allows you to do custom app development, which are easy to integrate with the platform. So you can come up with more creative ideas on Facebook than on any other platform. So what Lacta did was it made a custom application. It didn't just run campaigns on Facebook. It used the Facebook APIs to come up with innovative custom application which was rooted in consumer insight and which had the potential to become viral. So they incurred cost on development, but they didn't spend money on paid ads. So that is smart marketing. So particularly like Facebook and so on, you just check it out. There are many custom applications that you can develop. There are custom tabs that you can make. And there are companies like Woobox and many others. They can help you customize your entire Facebook page. And so you don't need a website. You check out, there is one restaurant in Delhi. Is there anybody from Delhi? Have you heard of a pub? I don't know if you go to pubs. 10 Downing Street. So 10 Downing Street, check out their Facebook page. It's wonderful. They do all business on Facebook. Probably they don't have a website. And what do they do on Facebook? They do table reservations through Facebook. They invite franchise inquiries through Facebook. They have TripAdvisor ratings and many other ratings integrated on Facebook. And they have Instagram integrated. They have menu on Facebook and so on. They have loyalty program on Facebook. So good thing is, you, unlike a website, you don't have to manage Facebook page. You don't have to worry about whether the site will go down or will it remain up. You don't have to buy hosting and so on. But of course, none of the data will belong to you. So tomorrow if Facebook says, okay, to access your own fans or your own content, you have to pay. You don't have a choice. So that is the flip side. So just leverage the strengths of each platform. All right, let's have a look at another campaign.
It's one of the lot of things to get to, beginning with Instagram. And if you're on there and you're in a New York restaurant, they want you to hook up.
Hashtag lá na busca do Instagram.
Nói về Instagram menu thì nhờ anh Hùng
promover menu pra Instagram.
Publicando fotos de deliciosos platillos en Instagram.
Takeaways or insights, anybody from the audience? So what do you think was good about this campaign?
Free of cost.
We love marketing which is free. Absolutely. And finance guys are always breathing down our necks, what is the ROI? So here, no problem in justifying the ROI. What else? Anything which is organic is wonderful. It's more powerful. The quality of people that you get from organic marketing is much higher than the quality of traffic from paid marketing. All right, what else?
Essentially, it was a crowdsourced.
Crowdsourced. So it's all user-generated content. And you are using it to work for you. Absolutely. What else? Anybody from the back? So what is it? How do we order food? We order food by looking at the pictures, because pictures speak more than the words. And the names of the dishes are all in Greek and Latin. You cannot understand what the dish will come by looking at the menu. And they will put some fancy ingredients and you cannot imagine what the dish will be. But if you look at the picture, you're more comfortable, you have more surety that what the impending dish will be. And that is the basic insight that this small restaurant identified and capitalized on. Sometimes I wonder why all the menus are not pictorial. Why only few dishes, they have pictures and others are just in text. It doesn't make sense. And how much does it cost to click a picture for every item on the menu? It doesn't cost. And people, research has shown that people order more those dishes which have the picture, they are ordered more. So this is very basic consumer need. And apart from that, it's social. So your friends are recommending. So there is an endorsement. And so the risk of ordering is less. So leverage on the friend's recommendation and visual. Okay, let's look at one more interesting example from Instagram. Interesting. So creating a menu specifically for Instagram. So this relates to the point that I made earlier, that we must understand the strengths and weaknesses of each platform or medium. So Instagram has this iconic square format, and this company created a product which was very suitable for the platform. And all of us know that youth, they like to click a lot of photographs, and they like to click photos of food, and this category is very apt for Instagram. Another insight which is coming from these couple of case studies: digital marketing creates a level playing field. Unlike your mass media, it does not favor the deep pockets. So whether you are an SME or you are an entrepreneur, you can just compete with MNCs, because you don't need big budgets. You can start digital marketing with 5,000 rupees. and the cost of failure is low. Even if you lose, how much will you lose? You are getting insights in real time. So you can pull the plug anytime. If it's not working, you put a stop. So it doesn't cost and it creates a level playing field. And many of these examples, they are restaurants which are located in one city. They are not MNCs. They are not big brands. So what we need is we just need to shake our heads and we need to stop thinking that for doing any innovative marketing, we always need deep pockets or big budgets. So that's not true. All right. Since we are almost out of time, a couple of more points and then I would like to wrap up. In these times, so when you look at digital, another thing which is very critical is content marketing. So entire digital hinges on content marketing. So if you look at digital, you have these three buckets. I'm sure many of you must have also heard of it. So you have POEM, paid, owned, earned media. So you have paid media, you have owned media, which could be your Facebook page or your Twitter handle or your YouTube channel, and earned media, which is how many likes or shares or tweets you are getting. So how much traction you are earning or how much engagement you are getting. So one simple best practice that I want to leave you with is that make sure your budget allocation does justice to all the three buckets. So paid, owned, earned. Typically in India, the mindset is that you put lot of money, 80% of your digital marketing budget on paid media. Because when you run paid campaigns, you immediately see traffic coming to your website. You see more app downloads. So you feel there is some result that you can show to your boss. Right? But in case of paid marketing, you run a paid campaign, the moment you stop your paid campaigns, the traffic will stop. So there's no longevity. So if you want longevity, you need to balance between your paid, owned, earned media. And simple thumb rule is allocate 50% of the budget to paid and 50% of the budget to owned and earned. So when you say owned and earned, it could be your microsite. It could be your blog, it could be your social media pages. And why do you need money if you are not running a campaign? You need money for maybe making some custom apps, right, to do some creative stuff. Or you need money for content creation. So spend money on creating content, quality content. Era of quantity is over. We are living in the era of quality. Because there's already so much noise out there. Every day you are putting up a post on Facebook. Nobody is giving a damn about it because it's very mediocre. But if you cut down the post and reduce the quantity of content from one per day to maybe only three per week, but up your quality quotient, and you will suddenly see that there are more likes, there are more engagement, and there are retweets. So whatever money you are saving in creating that too much mediocre content, put it on quality. And once you get that engagement, then you can amplify it with paid. So that's one thought. So focus on content marketing and don't just spend whole money on paid media. And I think many players, many of you, or some of you at least, would be from B2B, so one last parting thought is that please do not think that all the creativity only applies to B2C. There are many lessons that we can learn from B2C and apply it in the context of B2B. And one example that comes to my mind is Cisco. Cisco had to launch a router, and router is such a drab product. You can't even talk about its features because it's insignificant, right? So a typical launch of a router, how does it happen? So there'll be some trade shows, there'll be a press release, and there'll be offline interactions with tech people. So it's not news making. But the same Cisco, many years ago, when they were to launch Router 1000 series, that was the name of the router, they decided to launch it completely digital. And what they did, they didn't do normal stuff. So they realized that all these techies who are the decision makers for buying a router, now these techies, they come from IITs or they come from NITs, and they have a lot of high aspirations. See, this word impact, no? It kills all of us. Everybody is out there wanting to make an impact. They get out of NITs and IITs, they want to join the corporate and straight away make an impact. Now people who have been working with Cisco for 10 years, they are not able to make an impact. But this rookie with just 1 month of experience wants to join and make an impact. So when they realize that how inconsequential they are in the entire scheme of things, that they are not able to make any impact and they are just doing mundane jobs. So these techies become frustrated. And where do they vent out their frustration? Any guesses? What do the techies do when they are frustrated? They write code. My God, code. They are already frustrated out of writing the code.
They bring the
routers. They blog. They go to Quora. They play video games. They are very high on gaming. And this gaming is not a teenage phenomenon. You just check out the statistics. Adults, all these techies in their 30s and 40s, they are heavy gamers. Cisco caught this insight, and to launch its router, it made or developed a game, a video game. And in the video game, Cisco router and other products were deployed as tools. And with the usage of these tools, the techie would emerge as a hero. So in real life, he is not able to become a hero, but in the Cisco game, while he is playing, he is emerging as a hero. So he is happy. And this game was the highlight of the Cisco 1000 series router launch. Imagine a conventional, traditional B2B behemoth like Cisco using a video game as a launch strategy for a very mundane product. And this was a huge hit. Another thing that they did was a very good presence on Second Life. Second Life, it's for some reason it did not succeed. But on Second Life, you can have your own avatar. So all of us, we are very, like, we try to be nice, good in real life. Sometimes we want to be naughty and play mischief and also play the bad guy once in a while. So people can go to the Second Life and they can have an avatar which can do all the things which are the latent needs. And that was a second hit. And these two were the highlights of Cisco launch router. So please do not think that B2B companies, they always have to be serious. They have to do conventional marketing. They have to do offline events. They have to do trade shows. No, they can come up with games. They can come up with interesting applications. And they have to, ultimately, B2B decisions are also made by human beings who are also the consumers. All right, that's all from my side. Thank you very much.